We're going to discuss an exciting new discovery of an ancient animal from Antarctica, which was widely reported in the press, but it's left quite a few mysteries which we're going to discuss and explain. The discovery was of a giant egg, the second biggest ever found.
Yeah, it was a massive egg. It was the size of a rugby ball, about 11 inches long, about 30 centimetres. Second only to the egg of the elephant bird, which was a massive bird, which lived in Madagascar up until not that long ago, actually. But this was a much older creature.
And it had dimples and folds in the egg.
Yeah, well, at first they didn't know it was an egg. It was found in the Antarctic, and it was taken to the Museum of Natural History in Santiago in Chile, and stood there for a few years where various people speculated what it might be. And then a Professor Clark from Jackson School Department of Geological Sciences in Texas was visiting, and she identified it.
As?
Well, she was able to look at those folds that you mentioned, and it was roughly egg-shaped, so maybe people had thought it was an egg, but they didn't understand why it was so sort of folded over.
And under the microscope, the researchers could see that there were membranes, characteristic of a kind of reptile egg. And although many reptiles, like these crocodiles, have hard-shelled eggs, the ancient egg didn't have a hard case at all. It was soft, like some of the modern-day snake eggs. And a soft case makes the egg hatch quicker, like it might need to in water.
Of course, found in Antarctica, but we assume that back then it was a reptile that was in the sea, not on the land.
Yes, that's right. Actually, you know, in a way, talking to you, it sounds strange that reptiles live in the sea, because we think of snakes on land, lizards, tortoises maybe, a few other things. But of course, even today, we've got about 7 species of marine sea turtle, and so many snakes, unbeknown to people, live in the sea. You know, they several species, the file snakes, the banded crates, and the yellow...
The Galapagos marine iguana as well, which I've seen. They're very adept under the water.
Yes, yes. So it's not unusual that a reptile lives in the sea, or at least likes the water.
In fact, another one comes to mind, the giant saltwater crocodile does very well in the seas off Australia, doesn't it?
Yes, actually, they've been finding that it migrates, because we tend to think of them as just perhaps around the coast or in estuaries. But in fact, they found migrations of saltwater crocodiles from northern Australia right up to Papua New Guinea, which is, you know, maybe 100 miles of open sea. They've even found them on oil rigs, which are sitting north of the coast in Australia.
So it's not unusual then to find reptiles in the sea, and we know for a fact from the fossil record that there were reptiles in the sea in ancient times, right back to the time of the dinosaurs.
Yes, well, this particular one was not unlike a large saltwater crocodile, bigger actually. And we have sort of circumstantial evidence about why this egg was the creature it was. There was no embryo inside it, so they couldn't tell exactly what it was.
But through studying hundreds of reptile eggs, they determined that the most likely candidate was an ancient marine creature called a mosasaur. What's more, in similar sediments to the ones where the egg was found, there were also fragments of juvenile mosasaurs. So the scientists conjectured that this egg was part of an ancient nursery ground where young mosasaurs hatched and grew up.
Do we know anything more about the area in which the egg was found?
Yes, they found this fossil on an island on the northern part of the peninsula of Antarctica. The island is called Seymour Island, and it's quite open and exposed. We tend to think of Antarctica as all snowy and ice, but of course there's rock underneath. Antarctica is a real continent with land underneath. And in the spring in some parts, particularly in the north where it's warmer, it melts. And the egg was found in a melting stream actually not far from a place where a large Mosasaur skull had been found a few years earlier.
Who knows, may even be the mother.
It could even be the mother, I think, if it was female. I think it was, yeah.
Okay, but look, let's just pause there for a minute, because Mosasaur, I'm new to until I read this paper. But there were reptiles, giant reptiles, in the seas at that time. So there were plesiosaurs and ichthyosaurs. And the plesiosaurs are a bit like anybody who's seen the illustration of the Loch Ness monster. Large body, large tail, large neck, and four paddle-like flippers. The ichthyosaurs were much more dolphin-like in their form. What do you think the Mosasaur looked like?
Well, we know exactly, because there's complete skeletons of them and they've been reconstructed. In fact, I've reconstructed here an animation of Tylosaurus, which is from a 3D model I found. One of at least a dozen or so known species of Mosasaur.
The front end is pretty ferocious, isn't it? I mean, a huge mouth and very sharp teeth.
Yeah, they were eating heavily armoured things like prehistoric turtles and massive fish. There's also some circumstantial evidence that they ate other hard-shelled animals, a bit like our modern nautilus. These were the Ammonites, an ancient type of mollusk or snail-like creature. And they lived at the time of the Mosasaurs and died out with them. It's not certain, but these marks on the shell of this fossil Ammonite are thought to be from Mosasaur teeth. For me, that really brings this alive, this sort of CSI evidence of a bite 68 million years ago.
The Mosasaurs depicted in popular culture, John, in the Jurassic World movie, it jumps out of an aquarium and snaps up a great white shark.
Yeah, that was the first aquatic animal that they had in the Jurassic Park series. Actually, of course, Mosasaurs aren't Jurassic, they're Cretaceous, which is the era that came after the Jurassic. But, you know, we're splitting hairs.
Yeah, it's called artistic license, isn't it?
Of course. And the other thing is that it was massively bigger than any that's been found, because it was eating that great white. And great white itself can be, you know, just over 20 feet, about 6 meters. And the animal, that looked like a little minnow in its mouth. And so that would have made the creature several hundred feet long, which has never been found. I think the biggest Mosasaur skeletons are about, they're big, you know, 15 meters, 50 feet or so. And in fact, it might even have been the other way around, because they were giant sharks at that time, like the Ginsu shark from the Cretaceous, which may have even taken on a Mosasaur. To have hunted near the surface of the
water, where it preyed on anything it could sink its teeth into. I mean, I love that whole Jurassic Park franchise. I think that the animation of the dinosaurs in general is just absolutely spectacular. And I think even, you know, hardened paleontologists and geologists think the same. The Mosasaur, despite the fact that it was giant-sized, it still gave the impression of that those enormous jaws at the front and the overall body shape, although maybe slight issue that I would take with the tail and compared to the animation that you've done, John. I don't think anybody that was sitting in the audience was having a look at the tail end anyway. Despite the fossil record for Mosasaur body skeletons, John, this is the first record of there being an egg which is laid as opposed to being found inside the body with the rest of the skeleton.
Yeah, that is amazing that it's an external egg, because, as you say, skeletons of little Mosasaurs have been found inside the mother skeleton. And there is evidence for other large reptiles of the time, like the plesiosaurs, also giving live birth because they've got embryos inside. So it's a bit of a surprise, perhaps, to find this first external egg of the Mosasaur.
Do we know if it was laid on land or in the sea?
Well, that's interesting. A lot of marine creatures, marine reptiles in particular, have to come to back to land to lay their eggs. Mosasaurs don't have feet, they've got their paddles, but maybe they could have sort of waddled up the early part of the beach anyway, and maybe a bit like turtles laid their eggs in the sand.
Yeah, I mean, it's unlikely that such a large egg could be laid in the sea, because it's bound to drift and not kind of find a very safe home somewhere.
Well, it's difficult to know, isn't it? I mean, I think there could have been shallow areas. Maybe there's a kind of compromise situation where they come into the cove, which is where these things were found, and they're in really, really shallow water, and they lodge it, they wedge it into a gap between some rocks. That would work, probably. And being soft, it would hatch pretty quick. So maybe there was that sort of compromise. I mean, these are big animals. They must have weighed many tons, so getting yourself on shore would make you vulnerable to other shore creatures that would have been around at that time. There were some very large dinosaurs.
Of course, back then, John, Antarctica was going to look very different from it does now, doesn't it?
Yes, you know, you're probably familiar with the idea that all our continents were moving slowly. They still are, only a few centimetres every year, but that adds up over millions and millions of years, these vast geological times. And Australia, Antarctica and South America were, about this time, about 68 million years ago, they were all joined up, and they were also further north, which means they were warmer. They think that they had sort of temperate rainforests. They weren't necessarily fully tropical, because it was still quite far south even then. But maybe the climate of, say, the east coast of North America, or even the UK. So probably quite cloudy a lot of the time, but, you know, very lush vegetation, I would imagine. They've found some spectacular fossil dinosaurs in Antarctica. I mean, we don't think of it as a place that has wonderful fossils, but of course it is, you know, because
underneath that snow, I mean, there's going to be lots of stuff which may be exposed due to climate conditions.
Well, that's happening now, isn't it? A bit more and more. And you can imagine with the strong winds that the snow gets blown off the rock, so the rock is exposed.
And that, I think, together with the melting of the ice in the spring, allows the scientists to get at the fossils.
I particularly wanted to mention a fossil called, I can't pronounce this, Cryophilosaurus, yes, I think it is, which is absolutely spectacular. I can put a few pictures up of it. And that comes from the Antarctic. But the point is that there are many fossils from the Antarctic, a lot of fossil plants, the leaves of those old trees and things that lived in that rainforest. That's all there. So it's very rich.
I can pronounce Cryophilosaurus. I'm just copying you. What was it?
It was a crested dinosaur. In fact, it has one of the most complete crests that anybody's ever found. Quite an interesting structure, actually. I'm sure there's some discussion about that.
Well, there's one thing we can be sure about, leaving the speculation aside. There are no more mosasaurs in the sea. What do we think happened to them?
Well, they died out at the time of the dinosaurs. Their fossil record, and the fossil record of mosasaurs is good. I mean, there's many different species being found, but it suddenly disappears around about 65 million years ago. The age of this egg is thought to be 68 million years ago, so just before the extinction event. And well, so why did they die out? Why did the dinosaurs die out? It's probably the same reason. They think a meteorite hit the ocean, what is now the ocean, in the Gulf of Mexico, something several miles across, and that threw up so much debris that the whole Earth was frozen they went into a winter for about 10 years, and that would have quickly killed anything that was cold-blooded. Also, the other animal that we were talking about, the Elasmosaurs, died out at the same time, so they were another big ocean reptile.
Elasmosaurs are just one of the main groups of plesiosaurs.
Interestingly, the ichthyosaurs, those dolphin-like creatures, they died out 30 million years before this, about 90 million years ago.
Definitely not the meteorite event in that case.
No, so that also suggests that there are, of course, other reasons why these large marine reptiles died out. And one theory is that the ichthyosaurs went fast enough to catch the fish, which were evolving into faster open water types, which, you know, sounds possible, but also the elasmosaurs were very efficient predators living alongside the ichthyosaurs, and they may have been better at feeding and outcompeted the ichthyosaurs eventually. But something bad happened 90 million years ago, and then something bad happened 65 million years ago when the mosasaurs and the elasmosaurs died out as well. So then you've got very few large marine reptiles left, and the mammals start taking over in the sea like they do on the land. So you get the whales, which are basically sitting in the same ecological niche that these large reptiles were.
Fascinating that we can take so much out of a crinkly little old egg about the size of a rugby ball, as you say, but it's great that the fossil record is there. And as we were saying earlier, John, Antarctica becoming more and more exposed, we're bound to find more fossils along the way.
Yes. I mean, I think just to find an egg, it kind of makes you think about the animal as a whole, you know, from birth to death. And that's possibly why an egg is more interesting than you'd imagine, because although we see bones, it maybe doesn't connect us as much to the life of the real animal that lived, you know, 65 million, 68 million years ago. But an egg does, because it was born somewhere.